And once this curve is constructed, it turns out to be a curve which Bernoulli described in his preamble to the problem. He said, "You will be amazed and delighted when you solve the problem to learn that it is a curve well known to geometers. In fact, a curve called a cycloid. This is the curve which a point on the rim of a wheel traces out as it rolls along a flat surface." In other words, and I think I've run out of space laterally on the board, so I'm gonna have to compress my drawing a little. Let this be a flat surface, and let there be a wheel over here, and let's follow as the wheel rolls along upside down. I have it rolling upside down, and as the wheel rolls along in this direction, let's follow the trajectory that this point traces out. Well, it's 2 pi is the circumference of the circle, 2 pi r. This is distance is 1, this distance is 2. Let's go 1, 2, 2r, 3, and 1/7. It's got to make one full circle in this distance, so it'll come to rest over there. The lowest point it hits is this low. When the wheel just starts rolling, like so, this one is almost moving in a vertical. So if we see what the curve does, this is what it does. That's the cycloid. And this is the curve you would get if you fixed up a pendulum so that the ball rolling on it truly occupied an equal time no matter where you started it from. And this is a problem solved by Huygens, the lens maker, some 20 years before Bernoulli posed the brachistochrone problem. Strangely enough, this was called the problem of the isochrone, the curve along which something has equal periods of swing no matter where you started from. Now, conceptually, the isochrone is clearly a much simpler kind of problem to solve, because there's a pathway whereby you can construct the curve. Starting from the bottom of the curve, you can mathematically formulate the condition that the curve should follow and build it from the ground up. Whereas the problem of the brachistochrone, where you're asked to find the curve from among the infinite domain of all possible curves, which satisfies a kind of global condition, the condition of minimizing the total time of trajectory, it's inconceivable almost how you get a grip on a problem like that. But it turns out the two problems have the same curve for their solution. It also turns out to be a principle which arises in physics again and again, that it's possible to phrase certain laws of physics in such a way that a global condition is required to be maximized or minimized. The best example pertinent to this question is the question of the trajectory that a particle of light will take going from point A to point B. And the condition is that it gets there in the shortest possible time. Well, you could say that means just that light travels in straight lines. And of course, in air or a vacuum, that's true. But if you're passing from air into water, to get from point A to point B, a ray of light, since it travels faster in air than in water, will take advantage of the fact by rushing to get up to here first, so it covers more of the distance in air, and then it'll go like that to get to its destination along this bent path. And it'll get there faster than another ray of light would have gotten there if it had just gone straight, like a dumb guy would do, because it gains more speed going in air where it travels faster. So here, property of light is described in the sense that it tries to get from here to there in the shortest possible time, which is kind of a strange thing to ask light to do. Because how does it sort of guess where to aim for and where it's going to turn? Whereas an alternate way of describing the trajectory of light is that it follows the trajectory up to the interface and then makes a turn according to a certain relationship relating the sines of the angles, which is Snell's law that people take in grade 10, where the sine of this angle is related in such a way to the sine of this angle. That's conceptually much more believable, that it gets to the boundary and then follows a certain rule in turning. But it's a remarkable fact of physics that again and again you find laws of physics that are expressible in either of these two ways, one of them that seems plausible and the other, which is how could it work that way, and yet they both give the same results. Let's do a song.